Hi everyone, I'm Mel and welcome to Thriver TV, the place to break free from narcissistic abuse with quantum tools and understandings. So today is an episode where I'm going to be talking about where people have said, I haven't had a painful childhood, so why was I narcissistically abused? And I hear this all the time, and that's why I really wanted to address that in today's episode. And you know, people also say, well, you're apart from, well, I didn't have a painful childhood, they say, well, I did have an abusive mom or an abusive dad, but I've forgiven all of that, I'm over that, I'm past that. So how can that have had anything to do with my narcissistic abuse experience? So I just really want to bring about an understanding about this, that there is always an inner trauma involved, I promise you. And in the 8 years that I've been working on this mission, there is not one person that I've either been directing in the Narcissistic Abuse Recovery Program or that I've worked with directly as a personal client, where when they've tracked the trauma through their body back to origin, that there is not a wound that matches exactly, you know, what's been going on in their life now. Even for people who vowed and declared that there would be nothing there, there always is something there. And then also too, always what happens is when you actually track and find that original wound, and then when you release it and you up-level it, what happens is people lose the attachment to narcissists. They're able to leave, they're able to stay out, they're able to get away, they're able to get on with their life, because they no longer have that unconscious inner wound that is allowing the narcissist to hook them and act out against them and get to them through that gap. Now, just on a side note here, I just want to add there, you know, when I've explained that to people, like people that have said, well, you know, you're blaming victims, and what you're saying is that if victims didn't have their wounds, then narcissists wouldn't be the monsters that they are, because they wouldn't be using that against them, etc. I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying that narcissists are deeply unconscious people, which means that they're never dealing with their traumas and their inner wounds. So they're always having the need to project those wounds onto people that have gaps that are unconscious. And what happens is when we clean all of that stuff up, we detach, we no longer fight back, we no longer hand over ammunition, we no longer hook it up anymore. And narcissists are then got to take that stuff off somewhere else. They've got to act it out somewhere else with somebody that still has unconscious woundings and they have gaps. So this is how life plays out. How life plays out is when we have unconscious, unhealed traumas within ourselves, those parts of ourselves project out onto the field and they come to meet us via people and situations. So what that means is that abusers are showing up, people are disguised as abusers showing up, triggering our wounds, so that is making the unconscious conscious, so that hopefully we can go to it and hopefully we can deal with it and hopefully we can heal it. And at first the message comes in a way to wake us up and to help get our attention, but when it's not getting our attention and we're not waking up, the message gets intensified, it gets, you know, bigger and more powerful. And this is most definitely, you know, what's happening on with abusers. And then what happens is that we're not realizing that, and it just gets worse and worse unless we become conscious. If we're not going to become conscious, we keep drawing unconscious people. Now, when we're understanding our inner wounding, what we need to understand is that there is so much more going on underneath the surface than what we've been contemporarily taught about. And now what a lot of scientific studies are finding is that, and they're proving this, that we're not just acquiring hair color or eye color or skin color, we're also getting genetic emotional predispositions and belief systems that we're getting from our forebears, through our DNA, through our generations. And also too, they're discovering that as a fetus developing in the womb. We're getting belief systems and emotional compositions from our mother and also what's happening in her environment. And also too, we also got through the original DNA at the time of our creation. We took on what our parents brought to the conception table. And what's so interesting is that ancient societies knew this. This is not new knowledge. This has been around for centuries. We were just trained out of not knowing this for centuries, for thousands of years. Ancient societies, they used to go and do a cleanse on their bodies, on their emotions, on themselves spiritually before they conceived a child, because they knew this. So also too, we hit the ground running as a child, and we're this voracious subconscious machine which is just soaking up information and messages at a rate of knots with no cognitive developed mind filter. We didn't have that till 12 years of age to be able to look at a message and logically detach from it emotionally and have a reason that didn't involve us. So as children, we became incredibly susceptible to all sorts of messages that, you know, when we have a logical cognitive brain, we can say, well, that was really harmless and that didn't mean that, and you know, that was very benign. But as a child, we're very childish, we're very emotional. That's absolutely not how we take on messages. So, you know, was there lots of room in all of that for us to have some sort of subconscious programming that wasn't healthy for us? Absolutely. And also too, we've all been in a world that is rife with unconsciousness and unconscious people and messages. So, you know, and three of the hugest unconscious damaging messages that our world has purported and pushed is that we have to get ourselves from the outside in, which is a futile bottomless pit that creates post-traumatic stress disorder right from the get-go, because it doesn't work. The second one is that it's wrong to love yourself, that it's just a stupid, pointless, or even narcissistic thing to do to self-partner. Which is just so interesting, because if we're not at one with ourselves, how on earth can we be at one with the world and others? And then the third horrendous universal belief system is that you are tainted and soiled and you're an unworthy sinner, which means that you're not okay as you are, which means that you're going to create a false self and ego that hopefully somehow can earn approval and love, because you're certainly not lovable on your own. So this is the world we've been in. So yes, we do have faulty programming. Absolutely. So, you know, even the most beautiful of parents, even the most conscious parents, were not trained some really important things. And that was that a child's subconscious has no sense of humor, that criticizing a child is not a way to healthily motivate them. It's a way that deeply shames their inner identity. And also to parents, we're not taught to be transparent and vulnerable to their children. You know, every parent can have a bad day or a bad moment, and then unless they actually said to the child, look, I'm so sorry, this is just my stuff, this had nothing to do with you, unless they apologized and were really humble, that child had no way of differentiating between this is my fault or that's actually just mum and dad's stuff. All of it was really damaging. So I could give you hundreds of examples, hundreds, that I've seen over the last 8 years where people, when they track through what hurts now through their body to the original source, which our subconscious knows, it's a vault and we access it when we know how to, and it will give us every pinpoint information we need to heal ourselves. I could give you hundreds of examples from people that have vowed and declared that there is, I don't have any wounding, or I'm through that, I'm over that. And people, when they say, you know, I've forgiven, I'm over that, I've done that, I want you to understand this. There is only one determinant. Actually, there's two determinants to know whether or not you are actually clean in your subconscious, which means that you're not projecting that shadow out to the field, which is then attracting more of that trauma. It's only two ways to know. And that is if you go back to those original events or those things that happened to you, really go into them in your energy field and really, really feel it. Do you still have a charge in your body? Do you still, can you find the trauma? Can you feel it? Do you have a charge there? Because if you do, it's still active in your energy field. And the other way is to, when you go to it in your body and you feel it out, you go into the story of it, does your mind grant you an up level? Does it grant you a gift? Does it grant you, Tiggy, you are being so badly behaved. This went on in my last video too. He's been grounded. It's just horrendous. But anyway, we'll get there. And it's so funny. You're a child and you just, yeah, he's paying me back. It's crazy. So, where was I? Right. Yeah, if you haven't got the up level, which is the gratitude, which is the gift, which is, you know, your brain synopsis pathways are opening up to a higher understanding. And I'm not talking about, you know, when people logically, egoically say, well, you know, I learned to be stronger and I learned that I deserve better than abuse. And I'm not talking about any of that. There's still defensive reactions and there's stories trying to talk ourselves into I've forgiven and I'm better and I'm evolved because of this. It's not that at all. That's not the truth. Evolution is the gratitude of thank you so much for this event, because if this hadn't have happened via you, I could not have made my unconscious wounds conscious and I couldn't have up-leveled. And I couldn't have reached this level of evolution and transcendence that I've been able to get to as a result of this. That's what I'm talking about. That's the wisdom. That's the evolution. That's the transcendence. That's the graduation. And if you have that and you don't have emotional charge left on it, if you just have a gratitude on it, you've dealt with it. That's the true dealing with it. Anything else isn't. It's still active in your energy field. So I hope that's really helped you understand this and that, you know, healing from narcissistic abuse is not a logical deal. It's not something that we just get in our head, switch off and shut down and don't go inside ourselves and self-partner and find out the true things, because, you know, we're running a really susceptible risk if we do that. We're highly prone to continuing our shadows playing out and manifesting, generating more of the traumas, the original traumas and faulty inner programming that we've never sorted out yet. So that's why it's so important to sort it out. So I really, you know, for the countless people out there that are saying, well, you know, I've dealt with that or I don't have childhood issues. Oh, I promise you, you will be, when you start going inwards and you finding out the reasons why you've been narcissistically abused, you will just go, oh my God, it is no wonder. How was it ever going to be anything else? I promise you. So if you're enjoying these shows, please subscribe to my channel and like and comment. And if you haven't as yet got your Get Started Pack, which is just a heap of resources to help you recover from narcissistic abuse, please sign up to my newsletter to do that. And I'd love you to come into one of my next webinars, the three keys to thriving after narcissistic abuse, so I can really help you find these wounds that you haven't thought have had anything to do with this, so that you can make the unconscious conscious, so you can heal, so you can transcend, so you can leave abuse behind. So that's it from me until the next show and the next episode. So keep smiling and keep thriving, because there is nothing else to do. So that's it from me. Lots of love. Bye-bye.